Hello and welcome. My name is Ben Brownlee from Boris Effects, and we are going to be looking at a quick start to particle illusion. So in this exercise, we're going to be looking at how you create a motion background and a transition element using particle illusion's presets, tweaking those up and customizing those to our effect, and then taking them out to use them in our edit. So let's get started. Okay, so let's start off in the particle illusion interface. Now, I'm not going to spend too much time going into this because we'll be going in depth in this in future tutorials. But suffice to say, we've got the interface split up into four different sections. On the left-hand side, we have our presets and the preset viewer. In the middle here, we have our parameters for when we start doing any work on our particles. And in the top right, we have the stage, which is where all of our particles are going to be living. And in the bottom right, we have our graph. And we use that to supplement the parameter changes we do in the middle section here. So the first part of our project is to create a simple background. And before I do anything else, I'm going to come up to project settings to make sure that my project is set up correctly. Now we have a number of different presets that we can go for. In this case, I'm going to be working at HD, 1080p, 25 frames a second. So clicking on that preset does all the other hard work for me. I'm going to take my duration down from 300 to 250 frames. So that's 10 seconds long with a frame rate of 25 frames a second. I'm going to leave motion blur turned off. We're going to come back to this later. I don't have to worry about mipmap settings. That's for another time. Now, the most important thing when you're starting out with particle illusion, and in fact, when you're even more comfortable with particle illusion, is the presets on the left-hand side. Particle illusion has thousands of presets that we can come into just by clicking down here, nice and easily. And if you don't see all of these categories, then it just means you have to go up and download emitters. So we go up to the help, go to download emitters. That'll send us to the Boris Effects website where we can register and download the emitters. When first looking for inspiration for what particles to use, I tend not to use this tree view. If I go up to view, I can go to my browse layout. And this gives me a much better idea of what the options are for me with regards to presets. And I can even come up here and search in the emitter. So I can search for something like fire. I could search for something like water or even backgrounds. This will help just to narrow my search for what I'm looking for. And we can preview any of these just by clicking on them, and we see a preview in the top. I'm going to search for dots to see if I can find my starting point. And I kind of like basic dots new 5A. And we can see what these dots are going to do if I just drag them in the viewer up here. This is the default behavior with this emitter. So I'm going to go back to my default layout, and there's my basic dots right at the top there. Now I'm going to just add this emitter to our stage. I can do this in a couple of different ways. I can double click to bring that into the center of our stage. Just undo that. Another way, if I go up to view preferences and have click in stage to add emitter turned on, when I have a preset selected in the left, I can just come in and click and create those directly onto the stage. And I can add more or less as I go through. I don't want any of these, so I'm just going to undo with Control or Command Z. And I'm also going to turn off click in stage to add emitter so that I don't accidentally add emitters when I don't want to. Apply on that. So let's come to the beginning of my timeline, double click to add the emitter to the stage. And now that I'm done with my presets, I'm going to change my view again to the edit layout. So this gives me more space to see what's going on my stage. Now, by default, this emitter is a point emitter. So it means that all the particles are being generated from a point. I can move that point around just on the stage there. We can even animate that up, as we'll do a little bit later. But I can also change how these particles are created. If I go over to my properties and open that up, I can change the shape of that emitter from a point to a line, or to an ellipse, or to an area, or to a circle. So I'm going to choose an area here because I want to make this as a background, and I'm going to make my shape fill up the screen. And now you'll see I have a few more particles than I had previously. In fact, if we look at the top right-hand side of the viewer, you can see that I now am generating almost 17,000 particles each frame. Now, this is too many particles. So to reduce the number of particles in the emitter, I can just come down to my number here and turn this down to something a little bit more suitable. Let's turn that down just to about 6, maybe. And this is looking pretty good, but I happen to think that these are a little bit too small. And there are different ways of changing up the size within the emitter. We have this rather tempting size parameter. And this does change the size of those particles. So we can change that up or down. But this might not be the best option for you. You can see that even though the particles themselves are bigger, they're actually not moving any further away from each other than they were when they were tiny particles. And that's because that movement is controlled by the velocity. Velocity here. If, on the other hand, we wanted to change both apparent size and velocity, we could use the zoom instead to zoom everything up. And this gives us the effect that I'm after. If I wanted to change the color of these particles, there are two different places to do this as well. Pause this for one moment. In my emitter, I have a tint color. So if I come in and turn this to blue, you'll see that nothing changes straight away, but that's because our tint strength in the emitter is set to 0. If I turn that up, the more I turn it up, the more everything tints towards my tint color. So we can get some quite interesting looks by not having everything at 100%. Maybe taking that to 50 and maybe changing that color to green or to a different blue there. But that just changed the tint on the emitter. So that just tints the particles that are already there. If I want to change the color of the particles as they're being created, I have to go somewhere else. And if we look down at the bottom of our emitter, we can see we have this other group called dots. And this dots group controls the particles themselves. And some emitters can have multiple particles within them. But my basic dots only has dots inside. So if I open this up, we get another properties, which I can open up. And it's here where I can control what my particle looks like. So I can change my shape from this nice dot to something like a ring or even a star. And we have lots of sprites within our library. And you can see all of the libraries that we have here correspond to the preset libraries that we have created or installed. Ooh, spooky faces. Let's cancel that because I quite like the dots. And we're really focused on the colors. So if I open up my colors now, you can see the gradient that's being used to create my colors. If I click on that, we go into the color gradient editor. So if I wanted these to be blue instead of the red, I can just click on my color swatch, come into maybe that blue there. I can also double click on the swatches and choose a darker blue here. Maybe take the saturation down on that just a little bit. I can even change where the stops are to change the distribution of colors among the particles. Now, as you can tell, we have a huge amount of parameters that we can be looking at. I'm going to ignore most of these because they're going to be covered in later tutorials. But one of the things I'm often asked is how we change the speed of some of these presets. You can see the bubbles themselves or the dots themselves are changing quite fast. Now, there are a lot of places where we can do the deep dive and really sort of fine tune these. But if we just wanted those to move slower, with most of the emitters, the easiest way to do that is just to increase its lifespan. Because a lot of the animation within these emitters is actually controlled by the life of the particle. That's how long the particle stays on screen for. So you can see just by expanding the life out, making these particles live longer, it takes a longer time for them to move through their animation between birth and death. So with a very short life, they're bubbling around really quickly. And with a much longer life, they've got time to sort of, you know, sit back and relax, you know, take in the sights a little bit more. Of course, we do that, then we might have to come into our colors one more time and just change up how we weight those colors there. So let's take these same principles and quickly create an animated transition. And I want to go back to my default layout so I can see my presets one more time. Now I'm going to use a preset called Fast Dots. And I really love this preset. It's got a lot of energy to it, a lot of vibrance, really like it. Okay, and I'm just going to double click to add this onto the stage. Let's come in a little bit through the animation so we can see where it is. And I'm going to just zoom this up so we have something that fills the screen a little bit more. And I'm going to quickly edit this from the left to the right. So I'm going to drag my emitter directly over here. And I can start animating this either by turning on animation mode with the key down at the bottom, or I can come up to my parameters and turn the animation on here to either linear or Bezier. And we're coming back 25 frames in. And I'm just going to move my dots over from the left to the right. And take that quite a bit off screen. And when I'm finished with my animation, I'm just going to remember to turn off the static animation mode. So turn off the keyframing mode so that I don't get myself into trouble. Let's play that through. And I can see that that's not quite going off enough for me. So I'm just going to come to frame 25 again. And just drag that off the stage. Let's play that through. There we go. And we can see that more or less, we've gotten rid of all of our dots. There are a couple of little stragglers here and there, but you know, that's fine. And I can change how I play back my timeline by clicking and dragging my play out to the frame that I want to. In this case, it's frame 67. So if I play that through now, it's just going to loop between those two, no matter how long my project was set up for. Cool. So this is looking pretty good as a transition. There's just a couple of things we need to change up. At the midpoint, obviously I need all of these to be a lot bigger so they fill the screen, so I can cover a cut between two clips. So we look in the top right hand of the viewer, we can see that my midpoint is frame 20. I'm going to come back a few frames, about 5 frames I think, frame 15, and I'm going to manually set a keyframe on the size. So come up, take that to linear, come to frame 20 again, and if I click and drag these up, maybe to about 625. And then 5 frames later, I'm going to frame 25 and take these back down to 100. And if we look down the bottom in the graph, I can see a representation of my keyframes here as well. So keyframes are visible on the timeline, in the graph, and you can see and move between them in the parameter editor. If I've got my timings wrong, I can select all my keyframes and I can just move them along. So I can then take this and expand this up and maybe shorten how long it takes to get back and forth. I can even change the timings back and forth. So I can see I probably only need that to go. And so I can get that there. And then if I play that back, we can see we've got just a couple of frames where we've got everything completely hidden. And that's going to obviously cover my cut for me. So I'm happy with this. If I come up to my preview background and go composite on checkerboard, we can see we've got transparency associated with this. So it's going to be absolutely perfect for doing a transition. Let's composite that back on black again. And I'm going to render this out. So click on render. And this will bring up our render settings. Now we have a full tutorial breaking down this render window, so I'm not going to spend too much time on it. Suffice to say, I'm going to choose where my file is going to be saved to and what it's going to be called. I'm going to call this one 01.transition. And I'll set up my render type and export range. And I'll just start my render. And this will give me a nice preview as we render this through. And what a pretty little ditty I get when it's rendered. And I've imported this into Premiere, but this works the same way in any editing app. And I can drag that down on top of my two clips. And then if I play that back, we get our nice animated transition. Now, not every codec that we export out from Particle Illusion can support an alpha channel, so it's important to choose your codec correctly. And definitely watch that dedicated rendering out of particle illusion tutorial. And this has been a quick start into particle illusion, where we've navigated and found presets. I also learned how to customize size, color, and speed. How to animate them up using keyframes. And finally, how we can render them out into a file that we can use in other applications. Now, obviously, this is just a tip of what we can start to do in particle illusion. So join me and John Dickinson as we take you through an overview of how to use particle illusion throughout the rest of this course. My name is Ben Brownlee for Boris Effects, and I'll see you again soon. Download Particle Illusion Standalone for free at boriseffects.com, including thousands of free emitter presets. Continue watching this Getting Started tutorial series to learn more about what you can do with particle illusion. And find out more about the plugin version of Particle Illusion with extra features, including built-in mocha motion tracking, at boriseffects.com.